Okay, let's begin. I'm Dick Stewart from the faculty here, direct the Guarini Center on Environmental and Land Use Law, and I want to welcome you to this forum on the future of nuclear power in light of global warming and the hazards exemplified, among other things, by Fukushima, the Fukushima incident in Japan. Let me, first of all, just give a little very brief background, and then I will introduce our panelists, then we will have open questions and discussions. There are a little over 100 operating nuclear reactor units in the United States, but most of them were built long ago. There were almost all the plants were built before, or started construction before 1975. And 10 years ago, the operating plants account for about 20% of our electric generation in the United States. But 10 years ago, one would have said, the nuclear industry is moribund. There are not going to be any new plants in the United States. But then there was a change in direction and in attitude, growth in electricity demand, rising energy prices, concerns about energy security, and global warming all reawakened interest in nuclear energy. President George W. Bush and President Obama have supported expansion of nuclear power with generous financial assistance, and Congress has approved that assistance. And there was talk in the 2005, et cetera, era of a U.S. nuclear renaissance. At this point, the bloom is somewhat off the renaissance, in part because of the recession, economic downturn, slowdown in demand for electricity, and the Fukushima incident has raised further concerns about the safety of nuclear electricity generation. There's also the failure to solve the nuclear waste problem. Congress in 1982 set a plan in motion that eventually was going to have the waste from our nuclear power plants, which have been building up at the plant sites themselves, disposed of at a site in a repository in Yucca Mountain. For Nevada political reasons, Obama canceled that plant, so that that facility, so the repository does not exist. There are concerns, including after Fukushima, about the safety of spent fuel after it's been reached its useful life at the reactors being stored in ponds, cooling ponds next to the plant. They are gradually being moved into dry casks, which are more secure and can be stored at the reactor site or consolidated storage facilities elsewhere. But the problem of nuclear waste remains with us. Abroad, we find a somewhat mixed picture for nuclear energy with the Fukushima incident causing a reconsideration in a number of other countries, particularly in Europe and Germany and so forth, where there's no prospect of new plants anytime soon, and consideration of phasing out some of the existing plants. But in developing countries, there is a strong interest in many major countries, including China and India, in moving forward with nuclear power. China in particular has a very ambitious plan to add many new nuclear plants. This raises security issues, nuclear security issues. We don't have to go beyond North Korea and Iran to say, all right, you need enrichment of natural uranium to create the fuel for our nuclear power plants, and those enrichment facilities can be used to make weapons material. Another aspect is reprocessing the spent fuel can be reprocessed to extract plutonium and uranium to make fresh fuel or to make bombs, in the case of the plutonium. And Presidents Carter and Ford in the 1970s halted federal support for reprocessing in the United States on fears of proliferation grounds, but a number of countries, France, Russia, continue reprocessing. Japan is attempting to bring a reprocessing plant online, and China's developing one. So the issues about security are worldwide, with concern, obviously, about proliferation, especially in developing countries. So there's a complex web of economic and environmental and security, as well as political and legal issues here in these questions. We have a terrific panel to address these issues today with coming from very different backgrounds. And let me introduce them in the order in which they will speak. Bill McCollum, William McCollum on my left here, is the Chief Operating Officer of the Tennessee Valley Authority. He's had that post since April 2007. He's trained as a nuclear engineer, but he's the responsible for all of TVA's power production, transmission, sales, and resource management. And and TVA operates 11 coal-fired power plants, 30 hydroelectric facilities, and has three nuclear sites at which there are six reactors. They're constructing a seventh and are planning to add an eighth. So he's coming from a major utility, a public a government corporation utility, with a diverse energy mix, and in a good position to assess the role of nuclear in that mix. Before coming to TVA, he was the group executive and chief regulated generation officer at Duke Energy, another major private utility in this case. Chris Payne is the director, Chris is down here at the far left, director of NRDC's nuclear program, Natural Resources Defense Council, one of our leading national environmental groups. He's headed that program since 2007. He joined it in 1991 and worked initially on with Russia and a number of other leading countries to develop the Nuclear Test Ban Treaty, which was signed by President Clinton, and to deal with the nuclear security risks occasioned by the collapse of the Soviet Union. More recently, he has focused on the nuclear renaissance movement and proposals, and the environmental and economic viability of nuclear power in relation to other forms of energy. One notable thing on his blog biography, he probably distinct and unique among the panelists in having received a presidential pardon from President Gerald Ford for his anti-war activities. Our final panelist is Michael Levy on my right, who's the David M. Rubenstein Senior Fellow for Energy and the Environment and Director of the Program on Energy Security and Climate Change at the Council on Foreign Relations in New York City. He's published a number of books in this field, Confronting Climate Change, a Blueprint for Strategy for U.S. Foreign Policy on Nuclear Terrorism, and most interestingly, I think, Untapped Potential, U.S. Science and Technology Cooperation with the Islamic World. Prior to joining the council in 2006, he was engaged in research and program activity in these fields at Brookings and the Federation of American Scientists. So I will now turn to William McCollum to start us off with his perspective on these diverse array of issues. Thank you, Bill.
All right, well, thank you. Well, I'll focus my comments primarily on the waste issues that you mentioned, because I believe those are some of the more important issues that we face among many that you touched on. But I need to start my comments by saying that since this panel is sponsored here at the NYU Law School, it's appropriate for me to say that our lawyers always want me to begin any discussion with a legal disclaimer, which is that any opinions that I express today are my own and not the positions of the Tennessee Valley Authority, either present or future. So with that, I would like to start with a personal recollection. Back in 1973, when I was in graduate school studying nuclear engineering, I was scheduled to have a job interview for a position with the company that at that time was building the nation's first commercial nuclear fuel reprocessing plant near Aiken, South Carolina. That job opportunity evaporated when the federal government took on the decision to first suspend and then prohibit the commercial reprocessing of nuclear fuel in this country. If you move forward now, 38 years later, if someone had bet me at that time that after 38 years we would not have a resolution to the policy of what to do with spent nuclear fuel and how to dispose of nuclear waste in this country, I would have taken the bet easily because I would have believed that the technology solutions are there, that the science is available to solve the problem, and that certainly solutions can be found. And I would have taken that bet and I would have lost my shirt. Over that period of time, however, I think the country's actually lost a lot more than that in terms of the time and money that have been spent in pursuit of a solution, a consensus here, and in terms of the loss of opportunity for leadership for the United States in the global discussion around fuel reprocessing and the handling of nuclear fuel, spent nuclear fuel, around the world. If you look over that period of time, after the government took the decision to prohibit commercial fuel reprocessing, a policy was set up under which the Department of Energy was charged with the responsibility of finding both an interim storage location and an ultimate disposal site for handling of high-level nuclear waste, and was charged with the responsibility to begin accepting spent nuclear fuel from utilities or licensed plant operators by 1998. That obviously didn't happen. And in that period of time now, we have pursued this site at Yucca Mountain, which now appears to be off the table. And whether it's off the table for good or not, the fact is that today we have 60,000 metric tons of spent nuclear fuel. In this country, we add about 2,000 metric tons a year. And so we'll soon pass the level at which Yucca Mountain would have been licensed to store that amount of fuel. And so the solutions to this issue, regardless of the policy on Yucca Mountain specifically, the solutions have to be broader than just a repository at Yucca Mountain. I think it's telling that in the aftermath of some of the decisions and the public announcements about the suspension or the death of Yucca Mountain, if you will, that a number of folks in Nevada were asked their opinions about why Yucca Mountain was not successful. And one of the most telling comments was that a project like this cannot be a federal project, it has to be a local project, which is just another way of saying what we've all heard many times, that all politics is local. And so you can't pursue the solution to a significant issue like this simply by taking a top-down, science-based approach and ignoring the wishes and feelings of people who would live in the area, particularly around where such a facility would be located. Now, being an engineer by training, I think there should be a sound, science-based approach to any resolution to the issue of spent fuel and nuclear waste, but anybody who believes that you can simply count on the science to overwhelm everybody's concerns, questions, thoughts about a repository or an ultimate storage location is doomed to failure. And so this top-down approach really has not worked at Yucca Mountain, and I believe ultimately could not work there or anywhere else. But also, along this same period of time, there has been this endless sort of progression of stop and start funding and a lack of focus on the real task of trying to resolve what to do with the waste from a policy standpoint. If you look more for a bright spot in the discussion of this issue more recently, I think it would be found in the recommendations of the President's Blue Ribbon Commission on America's Nuclear Future. The commission has made several recommendations which actually make some sense, including the notion of chartering a specific entity, a federal entity, with a more singular focus on the siting of an interim repository and ultimately the siting of a high-level waste ultimate disposal facility. and that that entity would have access to the $25 billion that are currently in the nuclear waste fund as a stream of resource that would allow them to have not only the mission and the focus, but also the resources to accomplish that goal. The Blue Ribbon Commission also recommended, though, that any future attempts to site such locations would take a consent-based approach. Policy decisions that were undertaken a number of years ago limited the opportunity of the Department of Energy and others to consider multiple potential sites and narrowed that choice down to Yucca Mountain, and that has played out as we know it has now. The commission has more recommended that you would take a consent-based approach, which would envision pursuing perhaps multiple opportunities where there's public support to do so, and then moving through an evaluation process while considering multiple potential opportunities or opportunity sites in this process, and then ultimately arriving at solutions that can gain public consensus as well as be scientifically sound under investigation. There are other more technical policy considerations that have to be dealt with, such as the discrepancy between the licensing of the waste isolation pilot project, which was successful but was licensed based on a 10,000 year study criteria, versus Yucca Mountain, which was saddled with a 1 million year evaluation criteria for which no real approved methodology exists to do that sort of evaluation over a 1 million year time frame. Those issues will have to be resolved in pursuit of a solution. I think if you look at the experience of the Tennessee Valley Authority in terms of how it might inform this concept that was recommended by the Blue Ribbon Commission, it offers some view into what an entity that's chartered with a fairly specific mission can accomplish. The Tennessee Valley Authority is the nation's largest public power provider. As was mentioned, we operate a diverse portfolio of generating assets because we're charged with supplying reliable electricity to over 9 million people and doing so at the lowest feasible cost. And to do that over a period of time, we've learned in some ways through some hard experience, but learned over our 78 years of existence, that you really need a diverse portfolio of solutions. So our vision at Tennessee Valley Authority for the next 10 years is to become one of the nation's leading providers of low-cost and cleaner energy. And to do so, we've taken several significant steps, including adding significant amounts of wind contracts, a very aggressive energy efficiency program, adding gas-fired generation as well as more nuclear generation, because that's our best technologically proven option for adding large amounts of carbon-free baseload generation. And we're retiring over 3,000 megawatts of coal-fired generating capacity during this period of time. So to balance the demands of our customers and their need for economical energy as well as reliable energy, we believe that a diverse portfolio of assets offers the best long-term option. That's what we're pursuing, and as we've been able to do that and maintain our rates at a very competitive level for our customers so that they can be economically viable during these hard times, I think it does show that a federal entity, a corporation such as was recommended by the Blue Ribbon Commission, with a more narrow focused mission, as opposed to the Department of Energy perhaps, which has many missions, a more focused mission and the resources to accomplish that mission, I believe could be successful in moving us forward to a resolution of our nuclear waste issues. To do that will require that we move through several stages. Near term, it's very clear that we will continue to store spent fuel at our operating and decommissioned nuclear plants in this country. The reviews that have been done so far, the technical reviews by the regulator and others, have substantiated that the fuel can be safely stored and is being safely stored at our sites today, both in spent fuel pools and in dry cask storage. And based on the lessons that we've learned from Fukushima, we'll certainly all be assessing our abilities and making sure that we have more robust capabilities to provide cooling water and backup power to not only the reactors but our spent fuel storage facilities. And we'll also be more aggressive in moving fuel from the spent fuel storage pools to dry cask storage after it's cooled for about 5 years and has lost about 90% of its original radioactivity. But despite all those efforts, the problem still remains, and no one that I've talked to believes that storage at the plant sites forever is the best ultimate resolution to this question. So it's a problem that demands a permanent fix in this country. It'll require a good bit of work to do that, but I believe a focused effort with resources applied over a period of time using a consent-based approach with sound science coupled with some degree of political will to move forward over time to a solution can be successful in resolving this issue for this country. It's an important issue, one that demands a solution, and I appreciate the fact that panels and forums like this are willing to take up the discussion of this issue. Thank you.
Thank you. I just want to add a footnote. This requirement that the federal regulators for the Yucca Mountain Repository had to determine that it would meet environmental standards a million years from now was imposed by a couple of judges in Washington, D.C. So, Chris Payne is next.
Following a congressional requirement that the NAS
yes, I give
conduct
sure
a study.
That.
So, yeah. Let's not beat up on the judiciary too much. It's not surprising to me, actually, that I agree with most of what Bill said, and I was remarking upon this at lunch, that since the bloom has come off the nuclear renaissance and some of the more exaggerated ambitions about what nuclear power could do for global warming and could do for U.S. energy independence have de-escalated somewhat, there's been somewhat of a convergence in viewpoint around what nuclear power can reasonably accomplish. I mean, if you look around the world and you realize how many countries, about 31, that have significant nuclear power programs, and how many of those are actually freestanding commercial enterprises as opposed to wards of the state, almost all of them are, to a greater or lesser degree, but usually a greater degree, wards of the state. They are socialist enterprises, more or less, in one form or another. And the most successful programs, such as France, are avowedly socialist enterprises. So, and then you think, well, if nuclear power is going to spread and it's going to be managed essentially by states, how many of the 135 or 140 states out there are actually able to manage successfully a nuclear program? Not very many. So that's an initial break on the expansion of nuclear power, or looking at nuclear power as a panacea for the world's problems. It's complicated, and it requires a very competent state organization to manage it. And then the second obstacle is that people are coming to grips with is the cost. And it's not so much the cost per kilowatt hour, because the levelized cost of nuclear electricity, depending on the amortization period that you use, if you use 30 or 40 years, can be quite reasonable. The major problem with nuclear power is the massive upfront capital cost. Just the sheer financing requirements. Most countries just can't raise that amount of capital. Or they have to do it through some sort of sovereign debt financing mechanism, again, implying a competent state organization with good finances. When you examine these kinds of fundamental trends, you realize that even the most ambitious nuclear power program in the world, which is China's, which currently supplies about 1.5% of their electricity, they want to grow to 4% by 2020 and to 15% of their total electricity production by 2050. So the most aggressive program in the world can really, you know, can get to 15% of China's total energy needs. We've come down a bit in terms of nuclear's contribution. It's closer to 19% now than 20%. And it may dip even further before there's some growth. But I think there's sort of a natural limit unless you take a completely state-sponsored approach the way the French did and make a national commitment and say that nuclear power is going to be your primary resource. There seems to be a natural limit in the world of somewhere between 15% and 30% for nuclear power's contribution. So it definitely has a role. It's playing a significant role in carbon displacement now, but it's not the answer. It's not close to being the answer. In fact, there is no the answer. A modest expansion of nuclear power could make a modest contribution to carbon displacement, but I think the exaggerated outlook that prevailed during the Bush administration has really dissipated. Now, if we look at the U.S. situation, I think there's kind of a convergence on this idea of chartering a federal entity to manage the back end of the fuel cycle. But that convergence will rapidly dissipate if, as some members of Congress are planning and some companies are planning, that mandate for the federal entity to store nuclear waste and find appropriate paths for storage is expanded to include reprocessing. And the moment that happens, the consensus goes away. So that's an important item to keep your eye on as we move through the process, whether Republicans in Congress move aggressively to add a spent fuel reprocessing component to this federal entity by basically amending its charter on the floor of the Senate, essentially. And there are currently plans afoot to do that. And there are important commercial interests, namely Areva, the French state nuclear corporation, that's pushing that agenda. With respect to spent fuel, there's one sort of refinement that I'd like to introduce. Bill said that, you know, we're storing fuel in pools, and we're also storing it in dry casks, and we tend to move the fuel after it's cooled 5 years. That's not exactly the case at most utilities. In fact, the pools have fuel that's 20 and 25 years old and even 30 years old. They've been packed and repacked several times, and they're storing anywhere from 5 to 7 times the fuel that they were originally designed for at some plants. And the National Academy of Sciences has reviewed this situation and put out a report in 2002 that said this is unsafe because these very densely packed pools are vulnerable to a terrorist attack. So this amount of fissile material is increasingly vulnerable if kept in this configuration. So it's a different argument than the sort of safety of the nuclear safety of the pool. It's a nuclear security argument that suggests we should start unpacking these pools and accelerating the transfer of the fuel to dry casks. I would add that there also is a technical reason. If you actually look at how the cools are pooled, that and various scenarios for loss of coolant, having less fuel in there creates a longer cooling time for the fuel before the pool boils. So there's a little bit of there's some still not complete consensus about this issue. Most environmental groups, including our own, and dozens of local groups have signed letters to the commission and to NEI, the Nuclear Energy Institute, and to DOE, basically saying we agree that spent fuel should be responsibly managed, and we'd like to see it moved out of the pools and put into dry casks, which we think is a much safer solution for the interim period. And my advice to the nuclear industry is, when you're looking at a consensus like that, take advantage of it. Don't fracture the consensus and the possibility of moving forward by ignoring what people are asking for or asking for too much on the utility side. So I think there's room for a reasoned solution to that, but with attention paid to where the center of gravity of public opinion is. And the there's an issue also with should we take all this spent fuel that's either in pools or in dry casks and eventually move it to an interim storage site that is called consolidated away from reactor storage. which would have to be constructed somewhere and have to be operated by somebody and would have to be paid for? Or should the utilities just continue to transfer at some steady rate spent fuel from their pools to dry cask and store it on site on concrete pads, which is what's being done now? And the consensus in the environmental community is that it's sensible to move spent fuel that's at reactors that have been shut down or that are soon to be decommissioned into an interim storage site, but it's not sensible to move fuel that's at an operating reactor where spent fuel is going to continue to be generated. Just better to put that on a pad after 5 years. And there's also a fear that if you create one or two massive consolidated interim storage sites, that the political momentum to find a permanent repository will dissipate, and then people will propose, why don't we build a reprocessing plant right next to the big interim storage site and move forward with closing the nuclear fuel cycle, which has a whole set of problems which we can discuss later. Finally, there's this issue of the sustainability of the nuclear fuel cycle we have today. And the advocates of reprocessing say, we can save a lot of mined uranium by moving to spent fuel reprocessing. And uranium, if we don't move towards reprocessing, uranium is going to become enormously expensive. And I buy the environmental motivation to the extent there is an environmental motivation. I buy the environmental motivation because actually uranium mining is quite harmful environmentally. There are some aspects of the nuclear fuel cycle that don't qualify as clean. And so when you see these clean energy ads, it's certainly clean compared to coal, but it's not clean in any absolute sense. It's not clean like a solar panel is clean or a wind turbine. When you look at the case for reprocessing based on the exhaustion of or depletion of uranium resources, you just can't make the case. If you look at the case of all base metals, over time, the constant dollar price is pretty steady, over many decades. And the same is true of uranium. There's not going to be a secular long-term trend that makes uranium ever more expensive up to that magic point where we can say it's economical to reprocess. It's just not going to happen. If you just look at the discoveries, since the big uranium price buildup of 4 or 5 years ago, where it shot to $150 a pound on the spot market, the number of massive uranium discoveries that have been sparked by that short-term price increase around the world, we're going to have plenty of uranium. And so the economics of the once-through fuel cycle are going to remain dominant. And every analysis I've looked at comes out this way. There's a range. Some people say, well, uranium would have to triple in price, but that's assuming that you could reprocess for $1,500 a kilogram, but the Japanese are about to open a plant that costs $4,000 a kilogram to reprocess. So creating a much larger factor that's required in the uranium price jump to make reprocessing economical. And even if you get over those hurdles, you have all the concerns about nuclear weapons proliferation and security attending a plutonium fuel cycle. So the consensus that the Blue Ribbon Commission is proposing and that we agree with, that we help take some credit in pushing them towards, is let's just defer that choice about whether we reprocess. Let's say it's not economical now, it's not likely to be economical for many decades, so let's just keep it as an option, as a technological option, but don't start to do anything along those lines and focus our attention on interim storage and disposal of spent fuel in a permanent repository.
Thank you very much, Chris. All right, Michael?
Thanks, Dick. I'm not going to focus on spent fuel and waste storage the way the other panelists have. I think they presented some fairly wise views, but I wouldn't want to leave you with the impression that I have no opinions on the matter. So let me start by making one observation about this whole 10,000-year, 1 million-year business. I have a a former colleague who I think used to wisely point out that we assess these 10,000 million year things based on increased risks of death from cancer. And if we don't have a cure for cancer, or at least some better treatment for it, in a million years, we have some larger problems than our nuclear waste disposal system. So some context is a bit useful. We didn't know much about cancer a million years ago. I want to take the title of this session fairly literally in my remarks and talk about the future of nuclear power after Fukushima. To do that, I want to start by talking a bit about the future of nuclear power before Fukushima. It's important to understand what about our current circumstances came before and what's new. I want to talk a bit about what Fukushima has changed, and then I want to talk a bit about what Fukushima should change, two different things. So let's start with the global scene for nuclear power before Fukushima. And what you saw, I think Chris described it fairly accurately, you saw potential for significant increases against the backdrop of current nuclear generation, but not necessarily enormous increases like some people have been promising a decade ago. And those increases were focused primarily in big, capable developing countries, particularly in China. And they were driven by a mix of incentives. And it's important to understand that in order to judge how things might change in the future. For some, it's diversification of fuel sources. Unlike in the United States, where we don't really worry about the security of supply for power, that is a bigger concern elsewhere. There are environmental motivations in some places. In some cases, domestic deployment of nuclear power is driven in part by industrial policy. You create a domestic manufacturing base, a domestic demand base, and it provides a platform for developing an export-oriented industry. In some cases, it certainly is. There is certainly a security motivation, a very explicit one. Countries want to hedge and have the ability to use their technology in order to pursue nuclear weapons programs at later dates. And then there's a related motivation that sometimes gets confused, and it's a bit more about prestige. So the UAE, which has been fairly excited about nuclear energy, I think falls in that category. Are they hedging so they can build nuclear weapons if Iran does? No. But are they making sure that they can tell their people we're as sophisticated as the neighbors? Absolutely. So it's important to make that sort of distinction. In the developed world, I think the trend was less toward a lot more nuclear power, but more away from opposition to nuclear power. So it wasn't enthusiasm, but at least a declining antipathy. And that was having some results, and it was primarily driven by climate change concerns, particularly in Europe, but beyond that as well. Nuclear power, of course, faced major challenges globally during the whole time. Economics were certainly a factor. Not just the lifetime cost, but in particular upfront costs of nuclear power, particularly in the developed world, and then at the other end of the spectrum in some of the weaker developing countries that simply can't handle investment in energy, whether it's nuclear or something else. It's important to remember that a lot of the big ambitions for nuclear expansion are in places that have trouble developing any kind of major power generation. There were certainly safety concerns, but I think those were actually receding as of a year ago, at least in the public mind. Waste concerns. And then the last was concern about nuclear proliferation. And the challenge, I think, has been defined fairly sharply in the last decade or so as wanting to separate the fuel cycle, reprocessing and enrichment, from the actual power generation, so promoting the spread of power generation while restraining the spread of fuel cycle activities. And one important thing to remember is that most of the places where we might foresee an increase in nuclear generation are places that already have nuclear weapons. Okay, so most of the increase in power generation from nuclear power would be in places like China, like India, not places where we have proliferation, where we have substantial proliferation concerns that are related to them getting a new ability to make nuclear weapons. India is a touchier issue, and we can talk about that later if we want to. But it is important to draw that line and to keep that distinction. In the United States, I think it came down much more sharply to cost. If you look at projections for nuclear power generation in the United States a year ago,
2 years ago, 3 years ago from the Department of Energy. And no projection is infallible, but these are decent projections, and the Department of Energy is considered fairly bullish when it comes to price on nuclear power. They were projecting, I think, 6 new plants by 2030 as of a couple years ago. And as of last year, they were projecting 5 new plants. Okay, so not huge numbers. What was happening? First, cost was already tough. And an explosion in domestic natural gas availability and a decline in domestic natural gas prices made it very difficult to justify nuclear power plants, particularly because the upfront cost of gas plants is so low, which lowers risk. What you saw, though, in a lot of mainstream simulations is if you ended up with a modest but serious carbon price, so a decent climate policy, you did end up projecting substantial gains in nuclear generation. Now, those models might be wrong because they might underestimate the cost of nuclear power, they might overestimate the cost of other options or the availability of other options, but you did see, when you modeled the kinds of legislation that was being discussed in Congress, substantial increases in U.S. generation. So that's where we were before Fukushima. Then the question becomes, what has changed after Fukushima? And I would submit that a lot less has changed than many people might have expected, given what has happened. There have been some big visible changes. Germany moving away sharply from nuclear power is the most pronounced one, though that might have happened in any case. Fukushima provided a political moment of opportunity to move forward on policies that the government was already interested in. And Japan may be seeing very large changes. I think that's still to be determined. Right now what we have is plants going being shut down for maintenance and not coming back online due to local opposition. And we will see when, come next year, the majority of Japanese plants are down, what sorts of decisions get made, particularly depending on the kinds of conservation measures that can be put in place and the natural gas costs that they will face if they want to really move quickly away from nuclear. And the biggest changes that are still unknown are in India, where public opposition could still be meaningful, and frankly in the United States. Because of the weak economic incentive for nuclear power now, we don't really know how this has affected public attitudes toward nuclear expansion, because we're not seeing that tested. And I think it would be folly to say we know what would happen if in 5 years there was an additional financial incentive, to say we know how people would react. The other change, and I think people don't tend to focus on this, is on the supply side of the equation. There's been a lot of ferment in the nuclear suppliers world, and one of the big changes was the rise of developing countries as suppliers. Korea and China were the most noticed, Korea already exporting, and China desiring to. I suspect that this sets back China's ambitions and helps Korea relative to China. The prospect of a Chinese nuclear power plant already struck fear into a lot of people's minds or hearts. And I think Fukushima just makes that worse. The Chinese have known that quality control and safety were one of their biggest hurdles in exporting, and this has only intensified that. Last, let me say a couple quick things about what Fukushima should change. Certainly it should provoke us to revisit our safety practices. Waste storage has been discussed a lot, and that's certainly been a focus. In the developed world, that will be primarily focused on through relicensing, I suspect, and these facilities variously come up for relicensing. And there is a question as to whether that is a wise way to approach things. If we have learned something new that says facilities are unsafe, then it's not clear why we wait for relicensing to deal with that. And if there isn't a problem, then there isn't a problem. But the politics of this in developed countries may be trickier, in particular the politics of this with existing facilities. Because in a lot of cases, operators won't be able to pass on additional costs to their ratepayers. They will be competing against fairly low-cost generation, and any new safety requirements will come out of their profits. And that makes for a challenging political situation. There has been a lot of talk after Fukushima about the need not only for improved domestic regulation, but also for international coordination and possibly new international legal requirements. I would not expect new hard international legal requirements for nuclear safety. There is enormous variation among countries, and there's also a lot of suspicion by individual countries that hard international rules would be used to constrain their development or to constrain their export industries. Even in the European Union, you can't get agreement on common rules for nuclear safety at the kind of level people might like. I find it difficult to see how the United States and China, for example, agree. But there is a lot of opportunity for soft law, for cooperation among countries, and in particular for industry-driven approaches. The most important prospect here is among suppliers. The nuclear suppliers world is highly concentrated, and that provides an opportunity for codes of conduct to actually have bite. And there's been an important effort by the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace, supported by the Sloan Foundation, over the last year or so to produce a voluntary but pretty substantial code of conduct, and has been surprisingly successful so far. And let me flag one last area for cooperation before I leave things. We've focused all of our thinking about cooperation and reform, or almost all of it, on preventing the next accident. One of the things that Fukushima should have taught us is that you can't count on preventing every accident. We're actually quite lucky that this happened in Japan. I say that in a very loose sense without any intent to be disrespectful to the Japanese. But they had very strong response capabilities, strong relationships with the US military in particular, and a very sophisticated economy and society. That allowed them to respond quite effectively. That will not be the case in a lot of the world. And we would be wise to put in place the sort of cooperative mechanisms that would allow expedited facilitation of cooperative responses to accidents, whether they occur in China or India or the Middle East, if those, despite our efforts to prevent them, actually happen.
Thank you very much. All right, there's a rich menu of issues that have been presented by the speakers, so it's up to you all to ask questions or of the panelists and pursue these issues further. Who would like to start? Yes. Maybe just briefly introduce yourself, please.
Sure. My name is Adam Cott. I'm a grad student at SCPS at NYU. For Mr. McCollum, so you said that one of the main missions for TVA is to provide feasible prices, power prices, to its consumers. But you also said that you're going to be phasing out coal power and bringing in wind and nuclear. So those two typically have higher levelized costs of electricity. So how do the two sort of work together, providing feasible prices, but doing so through typically higher forms?
Yeah, great question. So it's important to understand the starting point, because the economics of what sort of moves you make with your power portfolio depend greatly on your starting point. So for us, our starting point was we're operating 59 coal-fired units, 6 nuclear units, and a variety of other sources. Given that, we had some coal-fired units in our fleet that currently dispatch at a fairly high cost, and given the new environmental regulations, if we projected the future cost of power from those facilities with full environmental controls, it was higher than other options. So we were able to secure some long-term wind contracts at fairly favorable prices. That requires some transmission adjustments on our part. We were able to do that. Our projected cost of our new nuclear assets, because we have the option of coming in and completing some partially completed nuclear plants at very favorable costs compared to starting a greenfield project, allows us to bring those in at an overall power cost that's very competitive relative to current coal-fired generation. We will still have a significant amount of coal-fired generation because a number of those units, 59 units that I mentioned, do provide fairly low-cost power and are already fitted with current state-of-the-art environmental controls. But we'll move toward a more diverse mix where a smaller percentage will be coal, larger percentage will be natural gas, renewables, wind, energy efficiency, and nuclear.
Could you say a word on what you're doing with your program on efficiency and whether you've considered solar in your mix?
We have several different programs. Our energy efficiency program is focused on ways to help in-use customers use energy more wisely or provide for cogeneration through a number of sources for our industrial customers. And so we have programs to help people learn how to use energy more wisely or make energy improvements, and some incentives to help with that. On the solar, relative to solar and renewables, we have programs that provide incentives to solar producers. We've made a decision that we're not going to get into developing solar projects ourselves because we don't think that's our core competence, but we provide economic incentives through some programs where we offer a takeoff contract at a fixed price for a long term that gives people an opportunity to go out and secure financing for solar projects or renewables projects. And we just put in place in Tennessee a fairly large solar power project under that program recently, as well as a couple of local solid waste methane power producing projects that are funded under that program as well.
Thank you. I learned yesterday that of course, California is the largest solar electric generator. The second is New Jersey, which has a program sort of like yours. And on all the roofs of the Walmarts are solar panels.
Can I make one quick comment? The other thing that allows you to square this is federal subsidies. So wind can be more expensive to generate, but it doesn't necessarily mean the ratepayer is paying more.
Pierre Hohenberg, physics faculty. This is a question for all three panelists. What is the lesson of Fukushima?
Chris?
In the first instance, I think there are three lessons. In the first instance, design your plant. Eradicate this distinction between a design basis and beyond design basis events, and design a plant to the best of your ability that can withstand all natural and man-made events. And the Japanese just clearly didn't do that at the time. I mean, if you look at sort of the design criteria for that plant and how it's sited vis-a-vis the ocean and where they put key components and the kinds of upgrades they declined to make over the years, they didn't do as well as they should have. And that so the question is why? And the answer is they lacked truly independent, objective regulation and enforcement. And so even starting with a design, with a weak design, and then believe me, the Mark I GE reactor is a weak design. We would never build one now. In fact, the NRC stopped licensing them in 1972 for their inherent design flaws. But starting with that weak design, there are things they could have done over the years to make the plant safer, and they didn't do them. And we face the same challenge in the United States. U.S. regulatory system is very good when the requirements of the regulators align with the economic incentives of the operators. So to the extent that having a reliable plant that operates at a high capacity factor coincides with safe operation, U.S. operators are very good at that. And in fact, they do most of it on their own without NRC intervention. When it comes to severe accidents and beyond design basis accidents and not very probable events, but things that could still happen, I think the NRC and U.S. operators do a very poor job, and that U.S. plants are vulnerable to very severe events. And so the lesson there is get better and bring those informal arrangements. The preparations for severe accidents are largely outside the formal NRC regulatory structure. Those should be brought within, and there should be formal requirements that are enforced at all plants. And then there'll be particular requirements that relate to the particular physical interaction of the plant with its environment that are unique to each plant. We just intervened in the relicensing of the Limerick plant near Philadelphia, because Exelon, which is normally a pretty responsible utility, is refusing to update their severe accident mitigation alternatives analysis, something that a court ordered them to prepare in 1989, 22 years ago. And they're being relicensed 13 to 15 years ahead of time. So we're talking about, potentially a severe accident mitigation analysis that's 40 years out of date, by the time the plant goes into its license extension period. So we don't know, you know, and this is after Fukushima. So this just set us off, and we immediately intervened in this proceeding because we just don't understand why a utility wouldn't do that analysis.
Michael,
did you? You asked all of us, let me just give you two very quick things, higher level, not technical lessons. I mean, the first is that things go wrong sometimes. And while you should spend a lot of effort trying to prevent those things, you should also prepare for when they do go wrong. And it's not just Fukushima that teaches us that. The energy world gave us the Deepwater Horizon oil spill last year that also taught us that lesson. And there's a related lesson, which is it's good to have options. That if you want, for example, to head in a low carbon direction, you want to have a variety of options because something like Fukushima can happen with substantially worse results, depending on where it does happen, and knock out one of your potential tools. Countries that have options, like the United States, have been more flexible in their ability to respond than countries like France that have a very high concentration of power generation in one technology and have less flexibility.
Bill?
So not surprisingly, I disagree with some of Chris's comments. I think that there are many lessons out of Fukushima. You asked about one. If I were going to pick one, I would say that to continue to base your view of severe accident response on the notion of predicting the events and the kinds of scenarios that get you into trouble and then mandating specific solutions for those kinds of events just takes you further down the same path. We already have a lot of the design and licensing of which severe accident response is a part of the licensing of plants in the United States. We already have a lot of work that's been done there. And so I think, to me, the lesson out of Fukushima is that you take a look at how you respond to the events that you don't anticipate and what are the fundamental capabilities that you need to be able to have a more robust response, which is the reason that we at TVA, the Monday following the events unfolding at Fukushima, put together a team to begin to assess our capabilities, not in terms of just the specific scenario or a specific set of circumstances related to Japan or any other scenario, but more broadly, what do you need to be able to do to have the most robust response you can in terms of communication, in terms of mitigation, in terms of recovery? And I think that would really be the more appropriate focus in learning the lessons from Fukushima and then proceeding forward.
Yes. Microphone up here, thank you.
Hi, I'm Akiba Fishman. I'm a first-year student at the law school here. We heard a bit about how the lack of consulting the local populations led to the demise of the plan to store the depleted materials in Yucca Mountain. And given the fact that the temporary solution is to store used materials at the plants themselves, does that play into siting decisions of new plants? Do you consult the local populations of where the plants are going to be located, given that they'll be living near these used materials?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think our recent decision with our Bellefonte plant, where our board, which is very sensitive to stakeholder input and public opinion, public input, made a decision to proceed with construction at Bellefonte Unit 1, which is at a site that doesn't currently have an operating nuclear plant, with an approval in the local population by survey of 89% in favor of that decision to go forward with the plant, and very strong regional support. But that was only because for the past several years, as we've evaluated that as a possibility, we've tried to work very hard to communicate with the public and all of the stakeholders. Not saying that all of the stakeholders will ever agree with any particular decision that we undertake, but we've tried to communicate broadly with the public, the media, and stakeholders, and be as open and transparent as we can about what we're looking at, what the decisions and the options are, and how we would go about making that decision. So we don't do everything right at TVA. We don't always communicate as well as we could, but we have to try very hard to communicate to the public and all of the stakeholders about all of these major decisions, particularly when it involves a long-lived asset such as a nuclear plant and the issues that are contingent with that.
Yes. Ted.
Hi, I'm Ted Kelly. I'm a second-year student here at the law school, and I've worked with Professor Stewart a bit on nuclear waste issues. I wanted to ask, because partly of the very high initial capital cost of plants, and also because initial licensing triggers a lot of regulatory requirements that relicensing doesn't necessarily trigger, the average age of nuclear power plants in the U.S. is going up a lot, and many plants have now been licensed beyond their initially expected lifespan. And I wondered whether the panelists felt that's something that we should be concerned about, or whether the regulatory requirements on relicensing and on continued plants are substantial enough to keep those plants safe.
Chris?
The relicensing reviews are actually very tightly constrained to the aging of plant materials and equipment. That makes it very difficult for citizens or state officials to actually intervene in a relicensing and raise safety issues. They just simply have been, the NRC has armored itself, and the licensees have armored themselves with a set of regulations that narrow the scope of the licensing review enormously. What's left is the National Environmental Policy Act process, the NEPA process, and within that, the Severe Accident Mitigation Alternatives Requirement is part of that NEPA analysis. So that gives you a way into a small part of the safety issues. This whole issue, I mean, the number one relicensing case in the country, Indian Point, where a state and several intervener groups are battling the NRC staff and the applicant. I encourage you, if as a law student, to go read those filings, because they're pretty interesting, what's going on. New York State is opening, slowly but surely opening a window into allowing discussion both of replacement power issues and safety issues. But it's taken 2 years, and it's like prying open a can without a can opener. I mean, it's incredibly difficult. And that says something about the nature of our regulatory system. It's really not what I believe was intended under the Atomic Energy Act. It's evolved too far in the direction of basically defending the interests of the licensees, and at this point, even defending the vested interests of the staff. Sometimes I find myself sympathizing with industry people having to deal with this very ingrown and somewhat arrogant and narcissistic staff at the NRC. And I'm not talking about everybody, but as people climb the ranks, they become more inward-looking and more stuffy and more self-important. And they just stop listening to outside experts other than their own advisory committee on reactor safeguards. You've seen this process. A very good staff task force after Fukushima put together a very good set of recommendations, rather surprisingly good for the NRC, given what we've come to expect of them over the years. And over the last several months, the number of commissioners allied with the senior staff have been gradually kicking these things into rulemakings that will last 4.5 or 5 years, delaying, saying we can't do this because we don't have adequate resources and so forth, and basically have eviscerated most of the recommendations. And counting on the fact that if you kick it into a 5-year rulemaking process, the political will dissipates and people will have forgotten about Fukushima 5 years from now, and the urgency will be gone. And this is to take a concrete example, there was a very serious fire at Browns Ferry, a TVA unit, a long time ago, 74, 75, somewhere in that time frame. And here we are, decades later, and the NRC has still not managed to implement the fire rule that dates from that accident. Go back. The lesson of Fukushima is we should, and I think I agree with the comment that it's fortuitous in a perverse sort of way that the accident happened somewhere else, because we can avoid a similar thing in this country with the right kind of renewed attention to safety regulation. But the problem is this glacial pace at which the NRC makes decisions, and you should make them. You should make nuclear safety decisions in a very considered way, but the way they are handling these Fukushima recommendations is basically designed to have them dissipate, unfortunately.
Well, so I have to, you know, I have to say that relicensing, you know, the relicensing methodology really was put in place to focus on safety. And so if you really want to focus on the safety of the plant, which is what you're trying to relicense, it's appropriate to look at the hardware of the plant, the structures, the components, how they age, what kind of issues you may have. Now, you may want to enact or change public policy through relicensing reviews, but to say that, you know, you ought to design relicensing regulations differently to allow a window for people to implement new public policy, I don't think that was the intent or the charter of the NRC when they put relicensing regulations in place. And to say that regulations are continuing to evolve and the NRC, for example, hasn't totally dispositioned all the questions around fire protection regulations, you guys are in a much better position than I am here at the law school to look at how the law has evolved since 1973 in many, many areas and to say, have we totally dispositioned all of the questions around any of the areas of law or regulation that you work with? Of course not. They're always going to continue to evolve. There are always going to be questions. We're always going to be dealing with issues and continuing to resolve those as we go forward. The latest round of that in the fire protection arena is the use of probabilistic risk assessment tools, which didn't even exist at the time that the original, quote, Appendix R regulations were put in place. So, yes, those areas are continuing to evolve, but I think it's unfair to say that the NRC staff or that the Nuclear Regulatory Commission staff is populated with bad people simply because we continue to evolve regulations and in response to trying to deal with questions and issues.
Yes. Patrick.
Hi, I'm Patrick Conroy. I'm a second year, and I've also worked with Professor Stewart on some of these issues. So, I mean, I understand the fact that since, you know, we just had the Fukushima crisis, that a lot of the concern is on the safety issues, which we always do when we react to something that's just occurred. But I was just wondering about something Mr. Payne said earlier about the security issues still that are still present with the spent fuel pools, especially given the fact that every year different plants are failing their force-on-force inspections where they, during the inspections in mock attempts to take these plants that sometimes the plant's security cannot withstand something they know is coming, so that it's kind of hard to predict that we'll be able to actually keep any kind of terrorist attack that is completely by a surprise. So I was just kind of wondering why there isn't more of an industry concern to mitigate this in advance in preventative measures by getting this fuel out of the pools and into a more secure form, so that while I mean, admittedly the chance of a successful attack on a plant is low, that the risk of what would happen would be, you know, devastating the results. So just wondering why there isn't more of a concern of getting fuel out of the pools and into a more secure storage and hard cask based on those terrorism risks.
Mm-hmm. Well, there are plans to move fuel more expeditiously to dry cask storage. And TVA, certainly we're looking at that, and as are a lot of other operators. You do need to balance what do you think are the competing interests and the most important concerns. So Chris mentioned earlier that you may have concerns that, gee, you have this fuel in the spent fuel pool that's been there for 20 years. Well, if heat generation and the potential for overheating if you lose water in the pool is your most important concern, that fuel is the least contributor. The older fuel is the lowest contributor to the heat generation in the pool, and so you would move the newer fuel out earlier to dry cast if that's your concern. If other things are your highest priority, you might make a different decision. So there are a number of competing factors, but people are looking at more expeditiously moving fuel out to dry cast. I do want to make a comment, though. I think I think there's a misperception about the statistics around security exercises, because the way those exercises are conducted and the preparation, the execution of those by the special forces type people who conduct those has escalated dramatically over the years. I've had personal experience with that. And so what's done is a team of highly capable people come in and get access to all of your inside information, map out their strategies, and then attack you. And they do it in escalating ways with really an eye toward trying to challenge every capability that you have and making assumptions that negate some of your capabilities to respond, so that they force you to come up with new ways to try to respond. It's actually, a lot of utility operators don't like it, don't like that process and fuss about it, but it's actually a very good process for helping people get better. What it's not a good process for is taking those grades and saying that over time it really shows you a trend of performance, because it's an escalating standard against which you're being tested, if that makes sense.
Well, it's just it's a cost issue, frankly. I mean, since 9/11 and the NAS report, there's experts' view in this. Nuclear security experts, people who really understand spent fuel and spent fuel behavior, and the vulnerability of the pools to various types of attack. The recommendation is to move fuel, and the NRC didn't move towards a rulemaking on this because industry opposed it, and their main ground is cost. If we could use the nuclear waste fund, dip into the nuclear waste fund to pay for accelerated interim storage, I think that a lot of the industry objections would fade away.
Michael, do you have any thoughts? Yeah,
strictly a cost issue from their point of view. They don't want to pay for it.
I was going to say something similar to what Chris says. It's important to distinguish, though, between the cost to industry and the social cost here. I mean, you're talking about something on the order of a tenth of a penny, which can actually be significant when it comes to profits and return on investment. It's not that significant from a social perspective. If you surveyed people around these plants and said, would you be willing to pay an extra tenth of a penny in order to remove this risk, I suspect they would say yes. So it's important to distinguish. And you'll see different phenomena in different places, depending on whether, once again, the operator can pass on the cost. And that a lot comes back to who ends up bearing the additional cost.
Yeah, I have to clarify, though. There's a cost issue, but for most operators, it's not primarily a direct cost, because many of us, including Tennessee Valley Authority and others, have reached settlements with the Department of Energy because they failed in their obligation to be able to take spent fuel in 1998, have reached settlements whereby the Department of Energy is liable for the additional cost of spent fuel storage arrangements during this period of time. And so if cost were the only driver and not regulatory and public policy issues, and the fact that we're not moving along on a public policy of what you ultimately do with the fuel, I think you would see a different outcome.
Well, we still have some questions from the floor, but we're out of time. The panelists, I'm sure, will be around for a bit afterwards to discuss any questions with you. Join me in thanking the panelists for an excellent presentation.
I learned a lot. Thank you so much.